Good morning and welcome back. Today is Wednesday, March 23, 2022, here in Taiwan. We just had a 6.6 earthquake about 20 miles epicenter from my home, about 1:40 a.m. here, and have had about three dozen aftershocks in the last 8 hours or so. And so that's the catalyst that's up for me and the island here. No damage to my place, but some hardcore rock and roll from at 1:40 in the morning, with a couple of fours and fives coming soon after. And it's sort of apropos to the current talk today, which probably will start a series, but it's sort of riffing and free association or free associative style of giving lectures or starting series as before from the Veiled Mind. And you'll see that there's actually a lot, there's a interesting path from the discussion of the Veiled Mind, aspects of that phenomenon, to the current talk in the current series, which you may see, it's a working title, not fully finished, but something like Hubris, Cosmic Justice, and the Tragic Cycle. Because I was doing some reading over the week, came in touch with some writing on what is called, what could be called a tragic cycle, according to the Greeks, ancient Greek, 2,000, 2,500 years ago. That began with hubris and ended with destruction. The notion akin to those whom the gods would destroy, they first drive mad. The madness is atis. And so there's the tragic cycle in accord with Greek, beginning with hubris, ending with destruction. In Greek, is the Greek words, which are not, I can't pronounce perfectly, hubris, atis, nemesis, tisis, or tisis. Hubris as insolence, outrage, pride, a certain affront to the natural order. Atis as madness, nemesis, which is commonly, you know, understand as like his nemesis, his enemy, but it's much more. It's really a divine vanquishing force, and then tisis as punishment, destruction. Those whom the gods would destroy, they first drive mad. Those of overweening pride, insolence, outraging against natural order, hubris, fall into madness, atis, thus are on the way or are scheduled for the meeting of a nemesis, divine vanquishing justice, and thus end up at tis's destruction, which is their karmic punishment. And so I want to draw from, and that's just the tragic cycle, which begins with hubris, which is all related to cosmic justice, which is all related to the current times on Earth, obviously. This is the end, and not my only friend, but this is the end of the 3D cycle, for those who haven't noticed. And whether it's in our lifetime or not, we don't know, I don't know, but it's day by day coming. Actually, for those who know about such things, which I know a little, from True News, it seems that the Pope, whatever that one is, intends to do a ceremony in Ukraine consecrating Russia to Holy Mother Mary or Mother of God or Mother of Jesus, whatever, Mother something, the you know, Mary principle, to consecrate Russia in accord with the third Fatima prophecy. The third Fatima prophecy, as far as I know, is about the end of the world or the end of the age. That the Pope is, by unilateral decision, by his own decision, consecrating Russia to Mother Mary or the heart of the mother or whatever, the Mary principle. I don't even know, you know, Catholic Saintology or something, but consecration of Russia to the Mother Mary is considered necessary for the fulfillment of the third Fatima prophecy given to the little girls in Portugal about 100 years ago. That's associated with the end of third density or the end of the age or the end times or the bringing back of the Messiah or Jesus or second coming or tribulation, Armageddon, apocalypse, and the end. So it also may well not be welcomed much by the Eastern Orthodox hierarchy leadership in Russia. So you've got Eastern Orthodoxy in Russia, and you've got Holy Roman Empire out of Rome, and the Pope taking the lead in consecrating Russia to the heart of Mother or the heart of Mary or something, deliberately in accord with the desire to fulfill Third Fatima prophecy, and of course this Ukraine-Russia war, is sort of the next holy war between the Holy Roman Empire, the Roman, you know, Vatican Empire, and the Eastern Orthodoxy of the entirety of the Slavic world that follows the Eastern Orthodox Church. Now this is a religious war, and that's pretty heavy, and this is the same kind of principle of forcing the hand of the Logos, like Sabbatean Frankism, if you know what I mean, forcing the hand of the One, or the Logos, to end the cycle. Mm-hmm. That looks like a little bit of hubris to me also. So, it's not just Russia versus Ukraine, or Russia versus NATO, or Russia versus US, UK, EU, NATO, but it's now the Roman, you know, Church, the Vatican, the Catholic Church of Rome, and their empire versus the Eastern Orthodoxy, Catholic, Christian, Eastern Orthodoxy centered in Rome or the, you know, the Slavic world. Okay, so with a very deliberate intention publicly stated to fulfill the third Fatima prophecy, which was sealed and, you know, people, some of you may know about that better than I. It was not fully revealed. It was secret. What does it say? There's all this controversy and about what? The third Fatima prophecy about UFO or about the end times, about the destruction of this country, that country, this block, that block, the end of the world, the beginning of the new cycle, the kingdom of heaven on earth and all that. This is it. Yeah, this is, we're moving into World War III. That's what it looks like to me. Maybe I'm just reeling from the aftershocks of the 6.6 earthquake, but no, I don't think so. This is a heavy time. And all that humanity does is done under or in the field of cosmic law, logoic law, cosmic justice, law of karma. If you want to know the future, you either are a seer who sees, which is really requiring six chakra activation strongly, and, you know, some seers see clearly and some seers don't, or all human seers generally see some things clearly, perfectly, and much else not. For sure. Anybody who thinks they see fully is subject to hubris and pride and insolence is wrong. And the ones that really have no limit don't speak much. Like Gautama, Nityananda, guys that really, really know, don't speak. Because it would be harmful to us in ignorance, it seems, or widely spoken. It's a very interesting principle, too, how those that are too far above the level of consciousness of the receiver do harm to the receiver to give that which the receiver is truly not ready for receiving. This is very interesting. But this is surely a time of great hubris. And so I want to read some pages on this and take our time as usual, step by step, slowly, slowly I walked, step by step, inch by inch, and pull out some of these important principles from the ancient Greek, totally pertinent to today, and set them in a metaphysical context and historical, you know, current events, current times context. So translating, first is a looking at the ancient Greek and their opinions and their beliefs, translating that into a integral metaphysical perspective of multidimensionality, where we know that the gods, so-called, are simply higher dimensional beings that are positive and negative. And they don't do punishment. They have some interplay, but the benevolent ones don't harm ever. And the negative ones do as much as they can based on, you know, human distortion. But there is karmic law. There is logoic law is karmic law, is of cosmic justice. Cosmic justice is of karmic law, is logoic, is much to be understood and way beyond most people, and me too. Gautama calling cosmology one of the achintayas, one of the inconceivables. So, karmic law and cosmology, both achintaya, meaning inconceivable, imponderable, don't worry about it, you'll know it fully when you get there. But to make sense of the present time, we do need to understand a bit more about karmic law and cosmic justice. And this tragic cycle is what I see as one principle, explanatory principle to help understand the current time. And that requires an understanding of the cosmic or of the tragic cycle from the Greek originally, and then its translation into a metaphysics that's in harmony with the raw material and spiritist tradition and notions of reincarnation and karmic causal sequence, meaning good seed, good fruit, bad seed, bad fruit, that which, and then translated into the polarities, right? So that those that are negative at base of beingness rightly will get reward or more opportunity for being evil. This is way beyond, of course, most anyone who can conceive, who thinks about the world process, because raw material is sort of a universal key to understand things, or a teaching that is echoed in Buddhism and Hinduism, but nearly never explored by those in those traditions, the notion of higher dimensional moral polarity, positive, negative, love, control. Buddhist, Hindus don't get into it much. And if you don't get into it much, one's own moral orientation remains a bit unclear. And Ra was talking about the importance of studying bellicosity, negativity, for develop as a portion of the development of wisdom, meaning fifth chakra. So even though the full understanding of karmic law and cosmology is beyond us, it's really inconceivable, but subjective knowing is not a poor friend. It's my friend, and making friends with subjective knowing leads us to more subjective knowing. It's still subjective, it's still in some ways relative, it's still limited, it's still incomplete. We have our limitations or blind spots, for sure. But we can understand more, and love of truth does the work. And that leads to great, true access to sixth ray, you know, because you don't, none get to the Father but through the Son. But the Son is not simply love or open heart, it's also fifth ray, the Vishuddhi Magga, the way of Vishuddhi is clarity, is Buddhi. Vishuddhi and Buddhi are similar, for sure. Vishuddhi chakra is the fifth chakra in Sanskrit. Buddhi as discriminative awareness or wisdom, discernment, as Nityananda spoke of it, is sort of the seeing of the mind from a detached position, seeing that I can know the mind, I can know phenomena, because I is separate from it, or I is a bit apart from it. Detachment from one's own mind, leading to greater discernment of the processes of one's own mind, as well as global, as well as social, as well as the integration of the physical and the metaphysical, right? So what we see is universal principles in play around us, very much of the tragic cycle in the end times. 3D human end times is very much a manifestation on the world stage of this tragic cycle. Hubris, actus, nemesis, thesis, or pride and insolence, madness and derangement, mental disorder, opponent or an enemy attacking, punishment, harm, leading to destruction. This is very much in play. So I'll start with this page. It's called, the website is called GreeceHighDefinition.com. Which is really like a tourist site about Greece. But the title is Hubris, Actus, Nemesis, Thesis, and an Ancient Universal Law. Right? Hubris, and I'll just read it and then go to town on it later. Hubris was a basic concept of the worldview of the ancient Greeks, which largely followed Hellenism, meaning Greek philosophy and culture, into modern times. The concept. If someone behaved violently, recklessly, arrogantly, and insultingly towards the physical and moral rules, the laws of the state, and especially the gods, the small g, in an overestimation of his abilities and power, physical, but especially political, military, and economic, he was considered to have committed hubris. This could be translated as insult, and could be described as behaving as if trying to transcend mortal nature and become God, thereby insulting and angering them. Using the form hubris to atis or ate to nemesis to thesis, we can say that the ancient Greeks believed that a hubris usually caused the intervention of the gods, and especially Zeus, who sent atis to the abuser, the insolent, the one who dallies in hubris and in outrage and pride, which and hubris and atis, which was the blurring and blindness of the mind. Atis as madness, blurring and blindness of the mind. This in turn led the abuser, the proud, to new offenses until he committed a very grave error which brought about the nemesis, third stage, the wrath and vengeance of the gods. So, divine wrath or higher dimensional or metaphysical wrath and vengeance of the gods, which brought the Tisus, fourth level, that is punishment and destruction. And there's a beautiful image, Goddess of Retribution, Nemesis by Alfred Rethel, 1837. Very pretty. Which is on the on the image, on the... on the frontispiece here. This whole philosophy, wrapped with the religious mantle to gain respect, or maybe because it was true, greater power and timelessness. See, this is presuming that everybody's just playing a game, that nobody knows an absolute truth, or there's no absolute. He's saying it's wrapped with religious mantle to gain respect, greater power, and timelessness. How about it has a religious quality because it is of the spiritual interdimensional. Is hidden. This whole philosophy is hidden in the law and structure of human nature. How about universal nature? And aims at the balance and harmony of human life. So you see, humans can't see beyond humans. We see in the works of the tragic poets many references to the punishment or purification that generations of people who fell into sins were subjected to, or cities that needed to be purified because of the disrespect of leaders. Hubris could be called recklessness or excessive enthusiasm, or, for example, the disobedience of Icarus or Phaeton, I don't know who, but Icarus is the one who flew too close to the sun. As hubris, we may Consider all three campaigns of the Persians against the Greeks, and especially the last one of 480 BC, so 2,500 years ago or so, which was prepared by Xerxes with pomp and arrogance and left the battlefields defeated in spite of the excessive size of his army and fleet. So the hubris of Xerxes, the king, I guess, of the Persians, going against the Greeks in 480 BC, leaving the battlefields defeated, though he had excessive size of army and fleet. So humans have been warring uninterruptedly for at least the last 3,000 years. To mid-Atlantis, I'd say. I'd trace it back to 15,000 years BP before the present. So Earth humans have been warring on each other for 15,000 years continuously, more or less, over the entirety of the globe, more or less. What a planet, or what a race. And so humans do hubris quite well, and thus boom and bust repeatedly. They boom, and then it turns to hubris, and bust by the tragic cycle where they experience Atis, Nemesis, and Tisis repeatedly, and don't seem to learn very much from it. Now, before I do a second pass on this page, let's just look at etymology briefly. There's not much to say. Wiktionary, hubris, goes to a Greek word, hubris. It's the Greek word directly, which is insolence or sexual outrage. And so there's a certain sexual quality to hubris in the original Greek, which is strange. Excessive pride, presumption, or arrogance, originally towards the gods. And the gods, you know, there are higher dimensional beings that can be called gods. It's a silly thing to do, but, you know, nobody knows anything really here. I mean, really, it just, you know, the more I learn, the more I realize how much more there is to learn, and how little most everyone here who speaks of cosmology or cosmic order or life know how little they know. And so it's you know, am I being presumptuous or wrong? Or one can know more and more and more. Mingun Sayadaw memorizes 10,000 texts pages, right? So I'm not there, but one can know more and more and more, and one will find how little everyone else knows. That doesn't mean one is better, not at all. Self's a being of infinite worth. Everyone's true nature is the same, actually, and of boundless worth. But in time and space, there is greater and lesser in quantity of knowledge, in quality of wisdom, quality of discernment, and comprehension of the truth that Ra says that the physical and the metaphysical are inseparable. And those that don't know that generally are those of presumption that it is not, those of materialist worldview, normally are of the, I'd say, hubristic or proud character, presuming they know it isn't, there is no metaphysical, they presume, because there's no proof. Oh, if there's no proof, it isn't, it cannot be. That's illogical, of course, but they don't know that. And so the hubris of humanity is profoundly rooted in presumption. And so that's why here on the straight up Wikipedia page, noun, hubris, countable and uncountable. It's definitely uncountable here. Excessive pride, presumption, or arrogance, originally towards the gods. And looking at the Greek page, the etymology of the Greek word is unknown, meaning where our word, English word, hubris, is the Greek word, hubris, which whose origin is actually unknown, pre-Greek, given its unusual shape and lack of a convincing Indo-European etymology. Nobody knows where it came from. It certainly came from the gods, or came from the logos, I'd say. And so it's all very speculative. When these guys get into proto-Indo-European etymology studies, they're just playing around, and there's no solid basis, because that's like a presumed linguistic basis before Greek and before Persian or something like that, before Sanskrit, right? Anyway, it's outward, up, heavy, strong, youth, maturity, adolescence, something, but it's sort of excessive yang, yin yang, excessive yang in mind, and spiritual grandiosity, or self grandiosity, self inflation, ego inflation kind of thing. And when we get to the page on Wikipedia on hubris, you'll see that it's very funny, it's very cute, cute for me, that of the in the section called see also, what else to see in terms of associated Wikipedia pages related to the page on hubris that associates with the same concept of hubris. There are many of our old favorites: Dunning-Kruger effect, overconfidence effect, self-serving bias. So yeah, these is it's associated with self-serving bias, associated with egocentric biases, associated with distortion, defense mechanisms, maintaining a falsely inflated sense of self, compensatory to a low sense of self or low sense of shame and guilt and regret, remorse, and self-blame. The weak self overcompensates by an exaggeratedly puffed up sense of self. So compensation by compensate by psychological, unrecognized, unconscious psychological compensation. Nearly everyone goes from a weak sense of self to pride and insolence and arrogance and presumption. If they do that, those that do that because of, seems to me, in general, commonly, compensation for a weakened or a low sense of self-esteem, a low self-value, low self-worth. Commonly, nearly everybody in this world has low self-value or low self-worth. Nearly everyone. And that's second chakra blockage, very much associated with the sixth chakra blockage that doesn't spiritualize the sense of self. The non-spiritualized sense of self is a second chakra blockage associated with a sixth chakra blockage, where they don't have the capacity to realize true nature or even sense true nature. Forget about realize, jhana. They don't have, they people are not aware. They don't have a sense of true nature, the true self, what I is, what self is, as greater than mind body, as greater than performance and function, meaning I'm not what I do. I'm the one that does. I is the one that does. I am the one that does, that has a sense of self, and I do better or worse. Sometimes I mess up, and sometimes I do well. I have strengths and weaknesses. I have success, and defeat. I have gain and loss. I experiences that, but that's not what I is. And so, but you don't get to the Father but through the Son. So if heart chakra is blocked, then sixth chakra is blocked, then second chakra stays blocked, then the sense of self stays deficient or of low self-value, low self-esteem, low self-worth, and then commonly is treated by psychological defense mechanism of compensation or overcompensation, where by way of arrogance or by way of avoidance and a sort of reversal, denial, and avoiding the pain of how I feel about myself because I think I'm just a shitty, low person because I made mistakes or I hurt people or I hurt myself or I failed. Rather than feel the pain of that and come to a realistic, healthy sense of self, I avoid that pain and cover over with presumption and pride and a puffed up sense of self. And then have all sorts of egocentric biases, self-serving biases, grandiose delusions, Dunning-Kruger effect, where I don't know what I don't know. I don't think that I don't believe I know, don't know anything. I think I know everything, or I think that all that I know is right. And by way of all that, avoid the pain of self-blame, regret, remorse, low self-esteem, not liking me. I don't really like me leads generally to I don't want to look at that. I don't want to look at how I don't feel well with me. All second chakra blockage. And basically then not healing second, not unblocking second chakra, retaining, remaining with second chakra blockage, distortions of the sense of self, particularly collapsed or damaged or wounded self-image, self-esteem. Not facing the pain of that, one does third chakra blockage, and that's the formation of this so-called ego, which is this the function of bias. It is the basis of bias. Bias, where essentially all biases are self-serving. Essentially all biases, presumptions, assumptions, intolerances, dogmatic perspectives, dogmatisms, are based in the third chakra blockage of this presumed egohood, which itself is the result of keeping second chakra blockage, not wanting to feel how much pain I'm in, not wanting to face the pain and the sorrow of how I feel about myself and how I feel. Thus, avoided, one lives, the people who avoid the pain of damaged sense of self or not liking myself or self-blame, self-judgment, self-criticism, do then some self-punishment, also do compensatory ego formation, forming ego. Ego is formed as the result of avoiding personal pain and sorrow and low self-value. Avoiding how I feel about myself and what I think about myself and who I feel myself to be, which is generally I'm not happy with myself. Avoiding that fashions ego by way of third chakra blockage, compensatory to second chakra blockage. That then goes to the basis of all, the mother of all, the mother of all biases is ego. And all biases, cognitive biases, are egocentric. Every one of them is self-serving in one way or another. And okay, but what kind of self is being served? And is it really being served, or is it being further distorted and blocked and harmed by the biases? So Icarus complex, narcissism, overconfidence effect, self-serving bias, vanity, elitism, Dunning-Kruger effect, dot, 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 dot. That's what we see at the bottom of the page on hubris. And that's the way it goes here. And this is a time of collective hubris getting its comeuppance. Apocalypse as revelation, Armageddon as a final conflict or choosing or decision point of virtue vice, the final crossroads in third density of the two paths, love and service to other, or control and service to self. All these are associated with collective comeuppance and karmic return, the outpicturing of karmic justice or cosmic justice by way of the law of karma, here at the end of third density. And so humanity is delivering its own comeuppance to itself. There's heavy pain occurring, which is terrible. And to the individual, to the nation, certain nations, to groupings in certain groups. And pain is terrible. And then there's atrocities. And then there's also, you know, the add-on of aggression and violence in mind. And the pain that comes out of all that is associated with the this tribulation time, which is a final, akin to a final end cycle, end times comeuppance of the tragic cycle of Nemesis going to Tisus, of divine retribution leading to punishment and destruction, or divine retribution as punishment going to destruction. So to whatever extent there is destruction, there's a lot of destruction already happening, mainly mental, emotional harm, forms of violence and harm at the mental, emotional, and now more at the physical, and more in the future in the physical, whether it's socioeconomic conditions in nations and cities, or wars, or starvation and disease and harm of that whole operation. The karmic comeuppance or karmic return or traumatic catalyst occurring is increasingly filtering down from the spiritual, mental, emotional to the physical. That's the way it goes. That's materialization, the downward cycle, the downward arc. From the war or conflict of metaphysical direction, positive, negative, Armageddon, that is coming down to very clear manifestations of nemesis tissus, meaning divine retribution or karmic retribution leading to destruction or harm or destruction and harm, which serves as a kind of karmic punishment or can be understood as a kind of karmic punishment and fully in accord with cosmic justice and the Logoic law. Not nice, but just. So let me see the time here. 36 minutes. That's the intro. So let's parse the page or look at that first page on Greece. High definition. Somebody checked out. And what is their discussion of, you know, just look at what they're saying. Because, I mean, you know, truth is everywhere. And there are deeper levels of truth everywhere when we have eyes to see. And so much of what's being said here is a reflection or derived from or straight on hit on universal truth here. So the first sentence. If someone behaved, and this is now talking about what is hubris, those that act this way are considered to have committed hubris according to the Greeks. Someone behaving violently, recklessly, arrogantly, and insultingly towards physical and moral rules, right? And you gotta, I mean, who can say, right? You gotta figure it out yourself. What is the moral, is there a natural order? What is the natural moral order? Different religions have different views. What is order? What is justice? What is infringing on others? Where is their law breaking? What is the law? Well, it's not just one thing, one word, the law. And so the law of one, what is the law of one? That's just the reality of unity, the reality that this many is one light, life. Okay, well, that's not really a law. However, acting in accord with that truth, it's a truth. It's an aspect, it's a sat. It's a, you know, satvid. It's a true knowledge. It's the reality of phenomena is that subject-object duality and multiplicity, manyness, is its nature is unity, which is one life. That is one light, that is one life. And thus, two, the experience of duality is illusory. Well, what the heck is the law? How's that a law? Well, to some degree, unless one, then there, the point is that there are two paths towards that realization, or living fully in that truth, or knowing fully the truth, living fully in the truth of unity, sixth density, higher self, to pass to that, attain, to that full realization of that truth, positive, negative. And, you know, then we have to get into the nitty-gritty that, in general, this page explaining hubris and the Wikipedia page explaining hubris comes from the presumption that there's only one path, that what Ra would call the positive path is the only path. Now, there's a negative path, and very few beings follow it, really, but it needs to be considered. And some of the people that we see, or many, perhaps, of those here who are behaving violently, recklessly, arrogantly, insultingly towards physical world, towards society, towards others, lying, cheating, stealing, killing, harming, tricking, treason, subversion, you know, all the seven deadly sins. Many of them are on the negative path. And so it's rightful for them to be evil. They need to be more evil. And so that's part of, that's derived from the metaphysics, the teachings of Ra, where there's two paths. That, like Ra talking about cancer, those that, that cancer and anger, this is from Ra's teaching, you can accept it or reject it. For those on the positive path, truly, at a metaphysical level, essentially, ontologically, essentially, souls as rightly on the positive path. If they don't love and accept and understand and move to forgiveness with their anger, anger will lead to cancer. For those on the negative path, essentially, if they don't control and vent in use of domination of others their anger, then that anger will lead to cancer. So the catalyst of anger must be met with the perspectives, the values of the positive path, for those on the positive path to not get cancer or to continue polarizing on the positive path. For those on the negative path, if they don't meet that catalyst of anger with the prevailing, you know, the required qualities of mind and behavior for those on the negative path, then that anger will go to cancer. That's a weird idea. But I think, you know, I commend ye to it to consider. So if someone's on the positive path, which is hard to determine, right? And of course, if they're behaving violently, recklessly, arrogantly, insultingly towards physical and moral rules or others, and then laws of the state, which at this point are completely corrupt generally everywhere, but especially the gods don't worry about it. But and then overestimation of his abilities and power, they're considered to have committed hubris. For those on the positive path, yeah, breaking Panchashila, doing violence, acting recklessly, carelessly, arrogance, pride, insolence in relation to others, and then, you know, lying, cheating, stealing, and all that, breaking rules that are rightful, especially rules associated with don't hurt people. They're cruising for a bruising. For those on the negative path, this is sort of necessary. The only thing is, it seems to me, for those that are on the negative path, the key is order for those on the negative path. And boom and bust is because they're not disciplined enough on the negative path to reorder subsequent to their violence. So violence and deception are the ways of control in general for the negative and negative individuals and groups. They do by deception and by force or violence their intention to further control and dominate. But they've got to reestablish order. And if they are mentally disordered, they can't do their progression on the negative path very well. Just like if you are mentally disordered, you can't do progression on the positive path very well. If you're mentally disordered, meaning you can't think straight, meaning the mind is a monkey mind jumping, or one swamped in emotionalism, or one's illogical, or irrational, or full of presumption, or avoidant, A damaged mind doesn't do positive or negative polarization well. And what the Greeks meant by hubris is particularly insulting to the gods, an outrage against the moral order. But it's also disorder in mind that leads to that. And that, while you can say that that's atis madness, there's a certain disorder that precedes madness. There's a certain irrationality, a certain lack of discipline. For those on the positive path and a negative path, lack of mental discipline, disorder in mind, disorder in the court, as the Stooges said, There's a disorder in the court of mind that precede that, it is involved in the formation of hubris itself. And so, in some cases, violent action as a response to protect the loved one may be fine, but recklessly is the key. Violently is one thing. Maybe force is needed for those on the positive path. Maybe it's clearly common to those on the negative path. It can be done carefully or orderly or in an ordered, disciplined way. But the key here is reckless. The key qualities of hubris, I think, are these qualities of disorder in the court of mind. Reckless, arrogant, insulting, in violation. It's not just violently, it's in violation of certain order and rules and mores. I don't know about rules of the state, but it's particularly, there is a natural order, whether you like it or not. Whether humans talk or not talk, there is a natural order. Humans derive their consciousness from something. Humans derive their breath from something. Humans depend on the non-human to breathe. If it wasn't for a higher source of life and light, there would be no breathing. The human body is not fashioned out of by nothing. It's fashioned by something. It's fashioned in an, by order, the form maker body, or higher dimensional law, is the basis of physical manifestation and causality. And so there's a huge presumption in the human mind, in most those with social power. But this is what leads in the end to destruction, is recklessness. On the positive and negative path, both. And arrogance, on the negative path as well. Arrogance maybe serves them in the short run, but if they overestimate their own power, they're out of order, and they're going to, and they're cruising for a bruising. By karmic law, not by me, by the karmic law. Insultingly, a certain smug condescension, condescendingly treating others. Certainly for those on the positive path, that's outside of love and goodness and virtue. It's a form of wrong speech generally. But for those on the negative path too, there's discipline. There's a disciplined mind that leads to an ordered mind that leads to clear reason, cool thinking, and right action that further increases their power. And that's not quite insultingly, acting insultingly and recklessly. And so, in general, there's a hell of a lot of arrogance among those in power, but there's a lot of recklessness in play today too. And we see that in individuals, we see that in nations, we see that in organizations. And that's what starts the tragic cycle, all of which could be called a tragedy, is a certain mental a disdain for discipline, for mental discipline. Mental doesn't, what the hell is mental discipline? It means being careful. The opposite of reckless means careful. Arrogant. It means the opposite of arrogant is realistic. Humble, not really, I'd say, but realistically self-assessed. I know my strengths and weaknesses realistically. I know myself as I am, not I know myself as I like to be. My desire, my preference doesn't distort clear knowing of self, self-assessment, self-measurement. Accurate self-measurement, in some ways, is the opposite of arrogant. You could say the opposite of arrogant is humble, but paus, the meek, is strong, but tame and mild. So strength is comes from knowing yourself well. Mild comes from being reasonable and not wanting to do harm. So anyway, reckless leads to disaster. Arrogant pride before the fall leads to fall. Insultingly and in outrageous indifference to scorn of the natural order, which includes one's own relative power compared to others. Spitting in the face of all that surely begins the tragic cycle. Overestimation of abilities and powers. Hey, the whole litany of egocentric biases. Anyone, positive or negatively oriented, that has fallen into egocentric biases, self-serving biases, is persisting in error because it's wrong. It's a overestimation of their power, their knowledge, the veracity of their views, whatever it is. It's a wrong estimation. And arrogance is associated with that kind of misestimation. Wrong and faulty estimation. There's a big problem with that. All that is the basis of hubris. Then it can be translated insult. And so, as if trying to transcend mortal nature and become God, insulting and angering the gods. Well, I don't think that's quite the case, that higher dimensional beings are insulted. But karmic law pertains. And so, too big, you get smacked down. Too small, in righteousness, you might be helped. Arrogance, pride goes before the fall. That was, I think, somewhere in the Book of Solomon, Proverbs or something. Very Old Testament stuff. Yeah. But there's more going on here than just pride leads to the fall or the arrogant get cut down on positive or negative path, too. There's more going on there. But this is a time of comeuppance. That's an important point. Then, next paragraph, using the form hubris, optis, nemesis, tissis. We can say that the ancient Greeks believed hubris usually caused intervention of the gods, and especially Zeus, and for that you can say, generates a karmic return of sending aptus to the abuser called madness, blurring and blindness of mind. Blind, blurred, irrational, wrong thinking, full of biases, full of presumptions and assumptions that are mistaken. You can make a presumption and assumption that just happens to be correct. But there's also, in general, presumption, assumption is wrong. And that comes out of a blurring or blindness of mind, which is disordered mind leads to a confused mind. Confused mind is of irrationality, poor rationality, inability to think straight and get answers and find solutions. Or find solutions that make long-term benefit. The solutions found by a blurred and blinded mind or a confused mind or a mind under aptus are solutions that lead to punishment and destruction. So, carefulness in mind is critical. And that was one of the deepest level moral teachings of Gautama is be careful with your mind. Guard your mind. Watch your mind. Watch your mind means don't let your mind become your enemy, or make sure that your mind is no longer your enemy, or don't let your mind become a home for bad tendencies that will harm you. Don't lose oversight of your mind, or else the mind will be your downfall. And so mind is one's downfall by karmic law. Don't need the higher dimensional gods for doing anything because they just, the negatives. Higher dimensional gods are positive and negative, Confederation and Orion, 4, 5, 6. Only the negatives would do harm or be involved in this tragic cycle. The positive entities, Confederation, they don't want to hurt anybody. They want, love and light forever. But Orion may be involved in this cycle for sure, puffing up hubris, arrogance, recklessness, and then intensifying aptus, madness, blindness in the one who's increasingly disordered in mind, for sure. Intensifying distortions, for sure. So you don't need Greek gods for the tragic cycle. But negative entities, astral entities will get involved for sure. I mean, who has lower astral attachment? Who has negative entity Orion parasitism? Those that are of significant hubris, positive or negative. Those that have become irrational and disordered and undisciplined and careless in mind. Then, as it goes on, from hubris to atis and madness, this in turn led the abuser. So, pride goeth before the fall. The fall can be called tisis. The pride could be called hubris. Those whom the gods would destroy, they first drive mad, atis. Why would they be destroyed? Why does destruction come to an individual or a society or a nation? Because of hubris. For either positive or negative path, it seems. But also, it does seem that, frankly, those on the negative path, while they are, quote, rewarded or continued negative polarization or polarization on the negative path by violence and their control and manipulation and deception and all that, controlling others, the negative path is full of disorder too, or full of violence, or full of destruction and crisis. The negative path is like a continual war, and it's either an orderly war or a disorderly war. In 4D negative, it's an orderly warfare, orderly social warfare, like the Romulan and the Klingon empires, right? The Romulans and the Klingons. Very much like that Star Trek episode where they one part of the planet did war on the other part by computers, and whichever computer won fed, led to the readout of how many people need to go into the vaporizing machine associated with the rightful loss of the war run by computers. In Romulan Klingon empires, everybody knows their place. Violence is done regularly, but order prevails. Here in 3D, where you have these inadequate negatives and inadequate positives, people positive and negative who are not harvesting either 40 positive, 40 negative over generation after generation or lifetime after lifetime. The violence is disorderly and results in greater disorder, and all kinds of ordering falls apart again. That's why boom leads to bust, because it was a disordered boom. And so the disordered boom or growth leads to a bust, which is more disorder. Then it pulls up and they reorder, and then patterns of hubris and disorder or carelessness arise again, and the new order busts again. That's the history of human societies for the last 15,000 years. So, the point is that the hubris, the one with hubris, the man or woman with hubris, is an abuser. They're abusive to natural law. They're abusing the moral order. They're abusive of the logoic law. They're out of cosmic justice. They're lawbreakers to the logoic law, to cosmic justice, to the karmic law. And they could rightly be called the abuser. That's why, interesting here, it says this in turn led the abuser. So the hubris, the hubristic one as an abuser, led that abuser to new offenses until he committed a very grave error, which means the final snowflake that brings down the avalanche, which brought about Nemesis, stage three, after madness that provokes and pushes and pushes and pushes, comes Nemesis, kick in the ass. Actually, or it's really, see, Nemesis is prior to Atis, prior to Tisis, the last, so three, four, three goes before four, usually. Nemesis, as an enemy, commonly we think, and he's my nemesis, or my nemesis. Nemesis really was an angered god, originally, or at least in this mythology here. In the original tragic cycle, the Nemesis was a god who said, enough. You've insulted us, or you've transgressed the natural order. You've been an abuser long enough, and you committed a very grave error. You have erred enough, and your error has reached up to the heavens. And time for Sodom and Gomorrah, lightning bolt. And so Nemesis is sort of, from a metaphysical view, I wouldn't say obviously wrath and vengeance of the gods, but the loosening of Juggernaut is juggernaut, the Sanskrit. It comes from Sanskrit. The word juggernaut comes from Jagannath, a god in Sanskrit, in Hindu mythology, which was like a big thing rolling down the hill. A juggernaut was the avalanche begins. Nemesis is the triggering of the avalanche, and the loosening of the juggernaut. It's the activation of Jagannath. Juggernaut's coming at ya. Jagannath has been alerted. Juggernaut is going to get ya, because you or the abusive, hubristic one has persisted in error long enough, and it's reached a level of intolerability to karmic law. Karmic law, it's time for precipitation. Karmic law is slow, 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 and then rapid. How do you go bankrupt? Slow at first and then rapidly at the end. This kind of thing. So there's gradual, 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 and then pang, materialization. Who could have seen it? But actually, it's visible in the invisible, or it's a current, it's a phenomenal, it exists. And if one could see energy lines and see the invisible, the non-physical, one would see just when, just how that final snowflake will start avalanche. And that it wasn't abrupt. The initiation of the avalanche is abrupt or sudden, but actually, it's just the natural next step from one snowflake mass affecting the gravitational structure, the field, the field of all the snow on the mountainside, as simply the next step. That which is fully extant, existent in the physical, in the non-physical time space, is ready for manifestation, and simply the next moment manifests fully in space-time, comes out of solution, becomes apparent in the beaker, and that is that transit from non-physical to physical is the triggering of Nemesis. So Nemesis, the wrath and vengeance of the gods, actually is the no going back, point of no return. Attaining the point of no return is akin to Nemesis. It's vengeance of God's Yah. Karmic law has no vengeance at all. Karmic law is. But there's the building in time space, and then there's the manifestation in space time. When the building in time space of the count, the agglomeration, accumulation, growth, steady growth of sin, or of, distortion, or wrong action, wrong speech, wrong livelihood, wrong activity, disordered mind and behavior, outrage against order, and really that which is rightly deserving karmic, painful karmic return, that which is depolarizing, you can say, for positive and negative. When that builds to a certain point, there's a point of no return. It builds to the point of no return. That's akin to Nemesis, as I see it, and that's not anybody's wrath or vengeance. It means ain't no way to stop it. It's over. The time of decision is over. There is no more choice. It will manifest. And that manifesting is tisis, or the punishment and destruction. And I think that that's what that there's a lot of relevance for in this discussion, or of this discussion, for occurrences of the present time. In individual nations and between nations and regions and East-West and Russia-Ukraine and domestic conditions in various nations, conditions in families and conditions in people's minds. there is a point of no return having been reached for some, or increasingly for many, who have long persisted in error, who have long been reckless, who have long been violent to themselves or to what they need, to what's best for them, and thus in relation to others too, commonly. And the karmic comeuppance is inevitable. It's unstoppable. The juggernaut has been loosed. Juggernaut is on his way. And what that brings for some people in some way, more or less, could be big, could be small, is what we could call Tissus, punishment, destruction, the collapse. That's of this time. This time is of the tragic cycle. And so this is the introduction. Next time I'll talk more about it, go into the Wikipedia page on hubris, and we will take the journey together. So I hope it's been helpful. Thank you for being here. Take good care of yourselves, and good night.